Tom mentioned that this was a presentation I did at a WordCamp in Austin, Texas last year. And since I'm just kind of standing in, I thought I could just do this real quickly and hopefully you might get something out of it. So, a little bit about me. My name is Reiko Beach, and we've been using WordPress since 2010 and using it for clients. We run the WordPress Meetup. We do WordCamps. I teach classes to beginners at Cape Cod Community College and a couple of other places. And we just love WordPress and love teaching people about it. So, I have 20 tips. The first one is have good hosting. And I think we already talked about that tonight. You can either have good, fast, or cheap. What do you want? Good hostings, and there are many of them. Good and cheap would be a shared hosting, like GoDaddy, Bluehost, Dreamhost, a bunch of others. Some of them that are fast and still pretty cheap, A2 Hosting and SiteGround, fast and good, Pantheon, WP Engine, Pressable. You've already heard all these names tonight. We're just kind of rehashing them. Number two, always use good passwords. In 2016, the most popular password was 123456. Yay! But if you're using any of these passwords, don't. And try and be imaginative. Try and not use simple passwords. Number three, back your site up. You can either use plugins that will back your sites up, something like Backup Buddy, Vaultpress, Updraft Plus. It can be done automatically for you. So you could say, I want my site backed up once a week, once a month. I want my site backed up, twice a year. Whatever your needs are, make sure that you back up your site. And so there's hundreds of different plugins to do that. Make sure you're backing up both your database and your files and folders. It doesn't help if you just back up your database. It's good to always have a backup of your database, but if you really want to try and recreate a site, then you want both your files and folders and your database. Now your hosting service will say, oh, we back up your sites. Just make sure when you talk to them that they don't back it up to the same server. We had that problem one time. We thought, we're golden. It was when we were starting out, and we had this hosting company, and they said, we back up your site daily. We're like, perfect, we tell all our clients, we're backing up your site daily. Guess what, they backed it into the same server, and when one day all of our sites were down, we called them up and they said, oh, someone hit a button and the fire extinguisher things went off and your server's dead. It's gonna take us a week to get back up again. It's like, well, you have backups on my site. They're like, yeah, that's the same server. It doesn't help if it's on the same server and your sites are being backed up. So, as a result, I always take backups of our sites. And it's very easy with, I use Backup Buddy, use something called Snapshot also, but you can download it to Dropbox or any of the off-site file host places where you can save your files. I said that, files and folders and database. You need to back up both. Number four tip is site security. You never want to see this, right? This says your website contains malware. There's some very easy ways for you to add security to your site. Number of different plugins I've used all of these in some different combinations. There's Jetpack that has a security feature. iTheme Security has a great security plugin. They also have a premium one, premium that adds more security. WordFence is another one, all-in-one WP security, limiting login attempts like you were told earlier. If they're trying to attack your site and you limit login attempts, then the chances of them getting in, and if you have a good password, the chances of them getting in are less. Yes? I would think something like the limit login attempts or the two-factor authorization. Those aren't going to be as heavy on your site as some of the other ones that offer a whole range of security. Security is another good one. Security is a good place to go if your site has been hacked, or WordFence. They both have something that will clean up your malware or free of $100 a year, and then protect your site for a year. So if your site does get hacked, it's an easy way to get your site cleaned up. Number five tip is stay up to date. Keep your site, do the updates to your site. 56% of WordPress installs are running out-of-date versions of the core, meaning that when you go and you say, when you sign into that thing, you see updates in the top, people are ignoring those. And you should always update WordPress, update your plugins, update your themes when new updates come out. Another good reason why you're taking backups, because if for some reason your site breaks when you do the update, you can revert back to the old version of your backup. So keep plugins, themes, and core up to date. When you're doing any modifications of your site, be careful what files you change. You should never change the core files. You should work in something called a child theme, so that when you do these updates, your site is still great. Oops. Tip number six, use good themes. There's themes out there that are free. If you go into the WordPress repository, you'll find a bunch of themes that have been checked out and their code is good. Many of the themes in there have what's called the premium model, where you go, oh, this is a really good theme, and you've uploaded. And then it says, oh, and for these three extra features, you need to pay. So even though things are free in the WordPress repository, they may have a step up that gives you more features. And it's called the freemium model. And then if you want some premium themes, elegant themes, which was mentioned earlier again, it's a good place to go for getting a nice themes, theme forums, Themify, there's a bunch of places to get them. My only thing would be if you're Googling free WordPress themes, check it out, make sure it's in the WordPress repository, because if it's not, there's a chance that they're trying to add some malicious code to your site. So always be wary when you're just Googling for free themes. I'd rather pay for a theme and know that there's good code in it. Same with plugins. So everybody knows plugins add functionality to WordPress site. This is old, so 52,000 plugins are available in WordPress.org in the repository. Almost anything you want to do, you can find a plugin that helps you do that. So going to WordPress.org is a good place to start. If you can't find something there, then ThemeForest or CodeCanon is a good place to go to purchase plugins. Sometimes they're as low as, you know, $8, $10 to get plugins with the functionality you want. But there's almost always a plugin. I think only one time I couldn't find a plugin, and it was for somebody that wanted to have a list of books from Amazon. And what was it? They wanted a list of books that could read of their reading list. And at the time, I couldn't find anything that did that without going and having somebody modify them, a plugin. So when you're in the WordPress repository, what you do is you check the theme, the plugin ratings. So they'll always tell you what version of WordPress it needs to be, what its compatibility is, when it was last updated. Sometimes you go there and it'll be like 6 months. And then how many active installs. If 6 months, a year, that may be fine for some plugins because they are doing a lot of functionality. But you should always check around a little bit. Go into the support forum, see what people, kind of questions people are asking, because that may be an indication that that plugin isn't being supported. So if somebody asks a question like, hey, I uploaded the plugin and it broke my site and nobody answers, then you know that you're not going to get support when you need it. But if somebody's answered within 2 days, then it's a good indication that you might get help if you need it. The other way of checking and seeing how many active installs there are and their ratings. Another good thing, always have an image on your page. Articles containing relevant images have a 94% more total views than articles without. And I have at the bottom, you'll notice I have links to the site where I got the information. I'm not sure about this, but it's more always more interesting to read a page, read a blog that has a picture. Where to find images, you can go to Creative Commons and do a search. Flickr has images, Google or Bing has images. But when you go to those places, make sure that you define the search for labeled for commercial reuse or modifications. Otherwise, you could be stealing somebody's pictures and sometimes they go after you. Getting has gone after people that have taken off the web one of their pictures. If you want to be really safe, you can go to stock image sites like Shutterstock, Adobe, Deposit Photos, iStock Photos, a bunch of them, and pay a little bit of money and be able to use it on your site. So there's no excuse not to have images on your site. Yes.
Yeah. Okay. And they're all high resolution too, so it's not like graphic quality. It's just a, I think a
Number 9. When you do use an image, make sure that you title it and use the image alt text. Fill that area in. See the big arrow under alt text? It helps with accessibility. So if people can't see the picture, then it tells them what that picture is. And it also helps with SEO if you use your keywords in the alt text. So if you want to put your image title in there, it's under advanced options. And you can put a title in there again and use your keywords and be descriptive. Next tip, image size. There's different image sizes that you should be aware of. The file size, that little thing when you look at your file manager, it says KBs. So you can tell the size of your picture. There's also the size of the image, which if you like go into Photoshop or something, you'll say it's 300 pixels by 200 pixels. And then there's another way to judge your pictures is by the resolution. 72 or web is good enough. 300 pixels is for print. So if you're pulling a picture and saying that it's 300, you don't need that high resolution for your web. And there's different types of files, JPG, GIF, PNG, and just be aware that the different types of files can be different sizes for the same picture. There are plugins that can help you reduce or resize and optimize image. WW Image Optimizer, WP Swoosh are two of the most popular ones right now. You just install it in your site, and whenever you upload pictures, it will automatically reduce the size of your images and make them optimized for the web. Number 11. You can embed content from other areas on your WordPress site. It's super easy to embed images, videos, tweets, audio, and other content. Some of the places that you can pull content from and just embed it with a short link. WordPress TV, PhotoBucket, Meetup, YouTube. There's a full list of them in the codex for WordPress. Tip number 12, remove formatting from copy text. Right now, if you copy and paste a Word document into WordPress, it now takes out most of the formatting. But there's a way that if you go to your page and hit the little bucket thing, see the little T, you could just take the text so that it takes out every single formatting, and then you can reformat the way you want in your WordPress site. Tip number 13, make sure that you set up your time zone. It's not so critical, but it's always nice to install a events plugin, and you're trying to figure out why when I say 9 p.m. it's giving me a different time. It's probably because you can go in and do the settings general, go down in your time zone. Since I was in Austin, I told them to do Chicago, but for here would be New York. And it's just, for me, it's easier than doing the plus or minus, because when daylight savings comes and everything, you always know that you're in the right time zone. Tip number 14, there are options in the admin area when you're in backend. So if you go to the top, there's this little tab that says screen options. And depending on what you're on, you get different options that you can do. So when I click down, when I'm on pages, one of my favorite things is it says number of items per page. You know how you have your website and you have 21 pages, and you go to the list of all the pages, and you have to go to page 2 to get that 21st page. You can change it right up here to say, I want 30 pages on that one first page. And then, again, if you have a lot of different options open, sometimes your pages, you have like 20 columns at the top and it gets too busy to read. You can unclick some of those boxes and then you can have a cleaner look to that page. That's where you have the list of pages. Tip number 15, there's a thing on your pages that says quick edit. Does anybody use the quick edit for things? It opens up a little box and you can easily change the title or the slug, change the date that it was done, change the template. So there's a lot of things you can do very easily. The other thing you can do is that you can do a bulk action. So say you realize that there are comments being spammed on those pages. You can go into your site, click all your pages and say, I don't want any comments anymore. So you can do it as a bulk action for all of your pages, same as changing the default template or something like that. So it's a very easy way to change a lot of pages all at once. Or just go in and change one page easily. Number 16, search engine optimization. One of the main things you need to make sure is you go into settings and reading and make sure that your search engine, that box is not clicked. A lot of times when somebody is developing a site for you, they may click that to discourage search engines from looking at your site. Make sure that's not clicked when your site is live. So WordPress is built for SEO. 80% of it is already there. But there are plugins that can help you get a little bit further. Some of the popular ones are Yoast SEO, all-in-one SEO package. And there's some articles that I read into that talk about some very good other options other than these two big ones. Number 17, Google Analytics and Search Console. Make sure that you sign up for Google Analytics and Search Console once your site is live. And don't forget Bing. But make sure that you sign up for both of those and add it to your site so that you know what traffic is going and what people are doing. Search Console will also tell you if there's something wrong with your site, if malware attacks have happened. A lot of times that's, I get a notice from the Search Console that something's wrong with my site. That's my first alert that something's not going well. Number 18, make sharing easy. We had a whole half hour, 40 minutes about how to make sharing easy for your site. So there's 1,283 social media plugins, and that's not counting the ones that are just for Facebook or just for Twitter. Just looking at these stats, 74% marketers saw an increase of traffic after spending just 6 hours per week on social media. So maybe you should supplement your website with a little bit of time on social media. 50% of internet users are active on Facebook. 52% of marketers have gained a customer through Facebook. and 35 have done so through Twitter. So that's why work on your social media. Number 19, the text widget and the HTML widget. There are two different widgets now in appearance and widgets. And it's the easiest way to add custom information to your sidebar or footer. Right now, text widgets that contain HTML, you'll get this little notice if you have an older site and now they have the HTML widget, that this widget may contain code and it might be best in the HTML widget. I've only run across one site where it was a problem and I needed to use the HTML widget instead of just the plain text widget, which used to be the only option to use. 20, we're on 20, yay. 20 is resources. There's tons of resources out there for WordPress users. WP Beginner has stuff that you can subscribe to, comes into your inbox, and it'll tell you lots of new little tricks, new plugins. WP Shout is another place, WP Tavern, they're all good places to keep up to date on what WordPress is doing. Of course, you need Linda, Treehouse, Skillshare all have different places you can go and get some training on WordPress. Facebook, LinkedIn has groups and pages. Facebook has groups. If you're using Giddy, there's a Giddy Facebook page and people go on there all the time and say, hey, this is a running for me. And people will answer that. I use either of them. There's a Facebook page for that. So just do a little investigating. You might find a Facebook page or a LinkedIn group or page that talks about what your interests are, what your problem is. And then, of course, there's local WordPress meetups and WordCamps that you can go to and learn a lot about stuff. Lastly, YouTube and WordPress TV. WordPress TV has all, not all, but a lot of WordCamps talks on it. So you can go in and you can search for the topic that you're interested in and probably find the topics and get it at the WordCamp. Here, California, Japan, Europe, that's talking about the subject that you're interested in. So don't forget that as a resource for you when you're trying to solve a problem with WordPress. And that's it. Thank you.